New Beginning Baptist Fellowship, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there.
Amen.
It's a beautiful day. So let's stand together. Let's lift it up to Jesus. Let's turn to 485. Stand up. Stand up for Jesus.
Stand up for Jesus.
Normally, I'd have everybody shake each other's hands and greet them. So as you're being seated, just turn around and wave to everybody. Say, Jesus loves you. Y'all Amen. Can go ahead and be seated. And choir, come on up.
Okay, Larry.
I'm
Amen. Go ahead. We'll have we
standing on this. If not, nope. We'll have our children to leave and go to their respective places today.
And as the children are going back, turn to 333. We're going to sing together, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, 333.
Stand, because you can't listen, you can't get to your billfolds and pocketbooks sitting down, because we're going to take an offering. We're going to worship God by giving here in a few minutes. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I know we're some of you shaking hands, some of you not. Just turn around and look at one another and smile. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in that fountain, cleansed by His blood, joint heirs with Jesus as I travel this sod. From a part of the family of, one more time, let's sing it out now. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in that fountain, cleansed by His blood. Oh, joint heirs with Jesus as I travel this sod. From a part of the family of God. Come on, men. Come on, let's take up the offering today. And we welcome everybody to the services. We're going to have prayer, and then we'll let you sit down. How about that? And so good to have you with us and to on this Father's Day. And we are honoring our dads, and some of our dads are still with us, and some of them have already gone on, and we're here in their memory today. Praise the Lord. And those of fathers out here, we honor you today. I see a lot of dads out here. Amen. How many had a dad? Amen. I know that. I'm trying to get some reaction out of you folks today. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, bless this offering. Lord, we're thankful for our fathers. And I pray this day will be a day that we'll honor them. And Father, we'll honor their memories as well. And bless our dads here today. Encourage their hearts. Strengthen them, I pray. Thank you for the privilege of giving. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
just as you promised, you came here to stay. I just had to pray.
Sing that chorus with me.
Jesus said, come to the water, stand by my side. I know you are thirsty, you won't be denied. I felt every tear drop when in darkness you cried, and I'm here to remind you that for those tears I died.
Jesus, I give you my heart and my soul, and I know that without God I'd never be whole. Savior, you open all the right doors. I thank you, I praise you from earth's humble shore.
Jesus said, come to the water, stand by my side. I know you are thirsty, you won't be denied. I felt every tear drop when in darkness cry, and I'm here to remind you that for those tears I cry.
Sing that one more time.
And Jesus said, come to the water, stand by my side. I know you won't be denied. I felt every tear drop when in darkness you cried, and I'm here to remind you that for those tears
I thought about the old song we used to sing, tears are a language that God understands. And I'm glad God understands every tear that falls from your eyes. Amen. And praise God. One day he's going to string them together like a bunch of pearls when we get to heaven. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, you know, the Bible does say there in one area that he puts our tears in a bottle. So he knows every tear you've ever shed. And he takes account of it. And I'm thankful for that song. I ain't heard that song in years. Thank you, Brother Steve, for singing that. And I appreciate that old song. I like the old songs there. And been around for a long time. Amen. Take your Bibles, if you would, please. I want you to go to the Old Testament scripture, the book of Judges today. The book of Judges. And be looking at chapter 7, the book of Judges. And I want to lift out of this passage of scripture some things that I think will be a help to us as I think about fathers, as I think about men. And just because we are dealing with men, it does not exclude you ladies. because all of us are included in what I'm going to say today. Folks, there comes a time when you got to take a stand. Stand up for Jesus, you soldiers of the cross. And my Bible tells me that God is looking for a man. God is looking for somebody among the people that should make up the hedge, stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it. Ezekiel 22, verse number 30. God's looking for somebody to take a stand. God's looking for somebody to make up a hedge, to stand in the gap. But the sad consequence there in Ezekiel, he says, I found none. I couldn't find any. And I think today that there's a scarcity of people willing to take a stand for the Lord and for the cause of Christ. The wicked think nothing about taking their stand. And oh, how we need to stand up for Jesus, especially in the day that we live in. And there's a group of people in the Old Testament scripture, in the book of Judges, that took a stand. And because they took a stand, 300 put 1,000 to flight. 300 men whipped, or we say it in old South Virginia terminology, whooped. Whooped thousands of Midianites. It just took 300. And they obeyed God. They took a stand. And God clothed them with the power of the Spirit. And they were led by a fellow by the name of Gideon. Gideon and his 300 started out with 32,000. And he said, now, if you're a bunch of cowards, you'll go ahead and leave right now, because God can't do anything with cowards. So what happened? Well, a bunch of them left, didn't he? How many left? 22,000 or something like that? Left 10,000. And so you had your cowards to leave. And then you had another group that was left, the 22,000. And they were the careless, because they didn't know how to drink water. They got down like a dog and drunk like a dog. He said, I can't use you fellas, because you've got to be vigilant. If you're going to drink water, you've got to keep your eye on the enemy. If you're down there drinking like a dog, the enemy's going to come up and cut your head off. So you had the cowards who left Gideon. You had the careless who got down on their paws, on their hands, and lapped up the water. That's how God says, this is how you're going to thin out the ranks. This is where you're going to separate the men from the boys. And then, thank God, he found another group, and they were the careful, because they got down on their knees, and here's the way they did it. Here's the way I'd do it, too. I'd lap up the water like this and keep my eyes out for the enemy. So you had the cowards, you had the careless, and you had the careful. Now, what we need today is vigilance. You need to be doing the work of God, but keeping your eye on the enemy. The enemy had entrenched in that hour because of Israel's disobedience. And you'll read that over in chapter number 6. The children of Israel, verse 1, did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them. Who delivered them? God delivered them. God delivered them in the hand of Midian for 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. Why did they? Because of their sin. Because they said, we don't want God. Remind me of the people of this generation. We don't need God. And then when God walks away, we ask, where is God? And God turns around and says, well, you didn't want me before. Why do you want me now? And we find in this text, beloved, in the 6th chapter, it was not the enemy that came in and overthrew them. God delivered them over to the hands of the enemy. You see, God can be our biggest threat. We're worried about China. We're worried about North Korea, Iran, Iraq, Russia, and all those others. But we don't seem too concerned about offending a holy God. And God can be our biggest threat in America. Romans chapter 1, he gave them over. He gave them up to a reprobate mind, a mind void of judgment. And I say to you that today that we're seeing the effects of our waywardness in this country, and we have excluded the laws of God, and we said, God, we don't need you, and God has walked away. And some people don't care. And some people are oblivious to it in the church because the church is asleep. God delivered them over in the enemy's hands. Verse 3 of chapter 6. And so it was when Israel had sown that the Midianites came up and the Amalekites. There's the Amalekites coming in too. And the children of the east, even they came up against them. Here's all the enemy coming up against them. Verse 4, and they encamped against them and destroyed the increase of the earth till thou come unto Gaza and left no sustenance for Israel. Then leave them no sheep, nor ox, nor ass. Verse 5, for they came up with their cattle and their tents, and they came as grasshoppers for a multitude, for both they and their camels were without number. And they entered into the land to destroy it. And Israel was greatly impoverished. I believe I could say United States was greatly impoverished. We may have wealth on every hand, but we're greatly impoverished, spiritually speaking, folks. Israel was greatly impoverished, and because of the Midianites, and the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. Well, we'll leave off there. You know the rest of the story. God delivered these Israelites into the hand of the enemy because of their sin, because of their disobedience. God needed somebody to arise to the forefront to lead Israel against the Midianites. And he found that one by the name of Jerubbaal in chapter 7, or Gideon. Chapter 7. Now, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but I just want to zero in down in verse number 19. So Gideon and the 100 men that were with him came up unto the outside of the camp in the beginning of the middle watch, and they had but newly set the watch, and they blew the trumpets and brake the pitchers that were in their hands. And the three companies blew the trumpets, brake the pitchers, held the lamps in their hands, left hands, and the trumpets in their right hands to blow withal. And they cried the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And they stood every man in his place round about the camp. And all the host ran and cried and fled. That's the enemy. And the 300 blew the trumpets. And the Lord set every man's sword against his fellow, even throughout all the host, and they fled. The Bible says here in verse number 22. Now, when you think about the book of Judges, you'll find the key verse to the book of Judges is back over there, I think, in chapter 21, where the Bible says in verse 25 of 21, in those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Now that's scary right there, because there was no king in rule. No king was ruling, no authority. There was lawlessness. And the Bible says every man did that which was right in his own eyes. It's where we are today. There is right there political anarchy going through the streets, destroying, destruction. There's religious apostasy in the pulpit. And that leads to moral apathy in the pew We could care less. Some folks could care less what happens to this country. And some folks could care less what happens to the cause of Christ. Now, the Bible says every man. Well, I'm glad that not every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Thank God for that. Because we read here in our text this morning that the Bible says they stood every man in his place. Every man in his place round about the camp. So there was a remnant. There was 300 that didn't go along with the crowd. Amen. There was 300 that didn't go along with the multitudes that were doing right in their own eyes. I brought messages about the doctrine of the remnant. There's always been a remnant. Always been a piece. Just a little leftover. Just a little band of pilgrims on their way to heaven that know the Word of God and love God and love the church of the living God that will stand in their place. Now, folks, let me say to you, we need men today that will stand in their place. They stood in their place. And so in this seventh chapter of Judges, we are stunned here by the miracle of victory in the face of an apparent defeat. Physically, humanly speaking, man, there's no way out. The Midianites and the Amalekites are all around us. They're like a bunch of grasshoppers. Thousands of them are coming down upon us. The hordes of hell have descended. So this chapter is a scene of struggle, and its purpose is threefold. Number one, to nail down the fact that God is present in this world. God is present in this world. Whether we realize it or not, or act like it or not, or want Him or not, God's still here. Amen. Yes, He's still here. Jesus said, I'll be in your midst. I'm still walking among the candlesticks. I'm still the Lord of the lampstands. I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And so Jesus is still alive. God is still sovereign. God is still omnipresent and omniscient. He's still active. Though we may not perceive Him, He's still doing something in this land. So this is to nail down that God is present. You believe that? God's present. I don't think half of you believe that. God's present. Amen. Lord, help us. Number two, to nail down the fact to establish His authority before all challengers. To establish His authority. Folks, there is an authority today in the midst of a lawless generation who does not want authority, who wants to kick all authority to the curbside. There is an authority, praise God, still at work in this land, and it's in the Bible, brother, right there. Right there is the authority. And God needs men who'll stand in their place to preach this authority, to teach this authority, to propagate this authority. If we don't stand in our place, somebody else is going to get in there. Something else is going to take over. And we'll wonder what in the world happened to our country. What in the world happened to our land. We already see what's happened to our statues and our religious emblems in this country. We're already seeing history being wiped away and all kinds of vileness on every hand. Then number three, to nail down the fact to show His favor that He has set upon certain people. Even though Israel is being overrun by the Midianites and the Amalekites, God, they're still God's people. And though they are in the land, not in belief, but in unbelief, they're still God's people. They're still God's peculiar people. And by the way, those of us who are saved, we're God's peculiar people too. We're the remnant of God just like Israel. is the elect of God. God has left us here to stand in the gap, to stay in our place. So this chapter this morning is a stinging reminder of the failure of human wisdom and the success of divine foolishness. Oh, how foolish to blow trumpets and to break some clay pots, amen, and to shout. How foolish that is. Certainly we need a choir, an orchestra. We need somebody to come along with a robe and say some rituals and have a little formalism about them. Maybe that'll help. No, you break the pitchers. You blow the trumpets of God, amen, and then you shout the sword of the Lord and of Gideon, because you've got to put the word of God in there. So here we find the failure of human wisdom. God sets aside human wisdom. Did you know that? Did you know human wisdom is foolishness with God? We think we've got it all figured out, don't we? Our politicians think we got it all figured out. But amen. But here's divine foolish. God says, I want to use the foolish things of this world to confound the mighty. That's true. Because when I look at the church, I see that. God even uses the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And it's the preaching of the cross. Now, God's way is a contradiction of man's ways. His thoughts are higher than my thoughts, and his ways are much higher than my ways. There's a lot I don't understand and a lot I can't figure out about God. And I won't till that day that I land on the shores of Beulah Land, and then I'll learn a little bit more about my Heavenly Father. But brother, there's some things down here I just can't. I'll just go and leave the secret things. Let him have a few secrets. The secret of success is revealed in my text of chapter 7 and verse 21. And every man stood in his place. Every. This is not a one-man operation. You believe that? You believe this is a one-man operation? No, sirree. This is not a one-man operation. Well, we hire a preacher to do our stuff for us. No. By the way, I'm not a hireling. Because the Bible says a hireling fleeth when the wolf cometh. The church is not a one-man operation. It takes a body. It takes laborers together, coming together and working for the cause of Christ. So he says every man, every single soul is important. Did you know you're important? Brother Gene, you're important. Amen. Miss Sue, you're important. Miss Lee, all of you are important. Brother Harvey, even you. Amen. And amen. And I'm good. I'm glad you still have your wife. Amen. She's still here. Hey, praise God. You are important, brother. And when you're not there, I say thy seat is empty. And wonder where he's at. Amen. Every man. And then he uses the word stood. That's the attitude of alertness. Ready to move out at the commands of the captain. So every man stood. Now, folks, our position in this world right now is a standing position. We need to stand up for Jesus. The Bible says, having done all, stand, Ephesians, the 6th chapter tells me. After all, you've done everything you can do. Just stand. Just stand. Well, preacher, I've done this. I've done that. I've made sure I pay my tithes. I made sure I read my Bible. I made sure I pray. I made sure I come to church every time the doors open when I can. I've done all this. Well, when you've done all this, just stand. That's what he wants you to do, stand. Having your loins girt with the truth of God. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. Having the shield of faith. Having the girdle of truth. Having the shoes of the gospel of peace, amen, and the sword of the Spirit. Just stand, amen. Just stand. Galatians 4:1-5 In verse 1, stand fast. You heard about the little old lady trying to sell that old dilapidated horse. Sway back. And the fellow says, little lady, does that horse run fast? No, but he can sure stand fast. He can sure stand fast. You may not be able to run fast, but praise God, you can stand fast. Stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made me free. Ephesians 6:14, I said a moment ago, stand therefore having your loins girt about with truth. Ephesians 6:11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to do what? Stand. God needs some people to stand. God needs men to stand. By the way, God, brother, has laid on us men more authority and more responsibility than he has even the ladies. We're to be the head. Well, I know that wouldn't get many amens, but we're to be the leaders. And I'm not discounting the ladies. You go in some Baptist churches, if it wasn't for the ladies, nothing would ever get done. You know why? Because the men sit on the back row and watch them do it. I've seen it. Well, let Sister So-and-so do that, preacher. We'll let her do it. Bless God, why don't you do it? God calls men. God calls men to preach. Even though some ladies are good at it. God calls men to preach. God's called us to be a leader, man. Leader of the family, leader of the home. He says in verse 10 of Ephesians 6, finally, my brethren, he's about to wind it up. Finally, my brother, be what? Strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Only the strong in the Lord can stand. Every man stood in his place. Emphasize the word place. Not just any place. Well, I'll just pick out my place where I want to, preacher, and I'll go there. No. God has a place, a definite design place for you. By the way, God has a will for you that he didn't have for me. I need to ask myself, am I in the perfect will of God? Am I in the will of God doing this? And if I'm not in the perfect will of God doing this, I need to get out of this and do something else. We need to make sure we're in the will of God. There is a place where we stand. And the safest place on God's green earth, church, is the will of God for your life. The reason why so many are defeated, the reason why they won't get in their place, is because they might get their feelings hurt and get on the outs with God and get on the outs with one another, and they get out of their place. When one gets out of their place, the whole team is penalized. Woo! The whole bunch is penalized. Because Samson was in the wrong place in the book of Judges, he lost his strength, he lost his sight, and he lost his superiority. And you know what happened to him. When Jonah got out of his place, he says, I don't want to go to Nineveh. I don't want to see those Ninevites saved. I don't want to see no revival down there at Nineveh. So he took ship. What did happen? He endangered the lives of others. And they didn't get saved until they threw the problem overboard. An old backslidden Baptist preacher. Jonah was out of place, and he spent 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly. God put him in the penalty box. He didn't know nothing about on the ice. What do they call that? Hockey. Moses didn't know nothing about hockey, but he got put in the penalty box too. He got out of place. He tried to kill an Egyptian, and the Israelites didn't even like it. And he had to flee, didn't he? He got out of place. David got out of place when he should have been out there with his men on the front lines fighting. He was on the top of his house overseeing and looking, and Bathsheba caught his eye. He got out of place. Simon Peter got out of place when he boasted that he would even die for Jesus. You see, it's possible for us to get out of place. It's possible for us men to get out of place. Us dads to get out of place. How important it is to be in the right place. Every one of Gideon's 300 stood in their place. Now, let me give you this, and I'm going to close. Every man stood in his place. And where they stood, there was, first of all, they faced a fight. There was a fight. And the Bible says in verse 21, and they stood every man in his place round about the camp. And all the host ran, and they cried, and they fled. You see, my friend, we're involved in a program of war. Unless, listen, unless you've had your hand in the ecclesiastical sand lately, we're in a battle. We're in a war in this generation. These imps of hell trying to destroy this nation. And the Bible calls them in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. We may call them Antifa. We may call them Black Lives Matter. We may call them all other names, but brother, behind it are the imps of hell trying to destroy this country. By the way, I think all lives matter. Red, yellow, black, and white, they're all precious in his sight. And I'm not demeaning our black brothers and sisters, no siree. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying lost souls matter, amen. Jesus died for all. He died for you. Lost people matter today. They faced a fight, and the fight will not be ended until we're promoted to glory. God's army of truth is in continual conflict with the forces of evil. But my Bible says there's no discharge in this war. You can't get out of this war. The only way you're going to get out of this war is for you to get up in the rapture or to go by the way of the grave. That's the only way you're going to get out of this war. Here are the Midianites encamped in that little valley of Jezreel. Above them on Mount Gilead stood these 300 fearless men in their place. They stood in a place which faced the fight, but after the fight was over, the foe had fled. Whew, try to say that 10 times. Stay on my preaching. I love you, brother. They stood in a place which, I'm going to say it again, Gene, which faced a fight, but after it was over, the foe had fled. You know a little bit about that, being in Korea. Our enemies are no less real than Gideon's today. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. My battle is not against the Democrats, the Republicans, the Liberines, and all these groups that are assailing on America. My battle's not against them. My battle's against the unseen forces of hell that are trying to dismantle this country. And by the way, they're coming after you. You're the real target. The Church of Jesus Christ is the real target. Why in the world will they let people riot and do what they do in the streets here the past few weeks but won't let people go to the house of God? They let them do what they want to in the streets of these cities. Burn and tear up. But, buddy, they won't let you go to church. Brother, I tell you what, the noose is being tightened on the church house. And we better get in our place, and we better stand, and we better put on the whole arm of God, because I'm going to tell you, they're going to come after us sooner or later. They faced a fight. It was a place where few were found. Not only did they face a fight, but few were found. Verse 22, and the 300 blew. Now, I like this. Oh, Gideon says, now when you see me blow the trumpets, you blow yours. And the Lord set every man's trumpet against his fellow. When you see me break the pitcher, you break yours. Those Midianites thought there was a whole big old army coming down after them after hearing the trumpets and the pitchers broken and the people shouting. Man, that's a big army. No, it's only 300 who stand in their place. Few were found. Started out with 32,000, but in the hour of conflict, praise God, there's only 300. And we think it's not by, oh, it's got to be by numbers. We got to have a large crowd. Listen, I'm not against a large crowd, but God's more interested in quality than he is quantity. Like the old preacher said, I'd rather have 100 men filled with the Spirit of God that'll backslide every once in a while than to have 100 men that'll come to church, don't care a thing about God. That don't mean we're perfect. It just means we find our place and we get in it. So Mount Gilead was a place where few were found, but this is the way God wanted it, because he knows the pattern of pride, doesn't he? He told Gideon when they had that 32,000, listen, that's too many, because if you go down there and whip them, you'll think you did it. You won't give God the credit. Pride. Pride goes before destruction. Holy Spirit before a fall. How much credit do we take rather than give it to God in this generation? Like the old fly in the ancient fable, which sat on the axle of the chariot and boasted about the glorious dust he stirred up. Y'all didn't get that, did you? God only had a few to work, but he never complains about the few out of the many. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm in the midst, God said. I'm in the midst. Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 30, I'm told that one of God's people would chase 1,000 and put two to flight. Just one. One with God is a majority. So it's a place where face to fight, few were found, and is a place forfeited by fear. Now, it was forfeited by fear. And in chapter 7, verse 3, now therefore go to proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and afraid, let him go home. If you are fearful and you are afraid, you might as well just go on. Because listen, God can't use you. God can't use you. So Gideon opened up the door, and 22,000. Man, that would give a preacher a heart attack. I can't write the denominational officials and say, I've got the biggest church in Putnam County now, or the fastest growing church on Moody Road. 22,000 has left. It's not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. And God said, Gideon, all I got to do is clothe you. I got to just put you on. Got to just put you on. Clothe you. Fear is faith in Satan. Faith is fearing God. Fear is a minus, subtracting what God wants to add. Fear is sin because it refuses to believe what God has promised. And God told Abraham to fear not, assuring him that he would be his shield and exceeding great reward. Church, can I tell you something? God didn't give you that spirit of fear. The Bible says he didn't in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. The Bible says in 1 John 4, 18, fear hath what? Torment. But perfect love will cast it out. Not my love for him, but his love for me will cast it out. Others are afraid of what others might think or say of them if they take a stand. What are they going to say about me if I go knock on their door and try to tell them about Jesus? What are they going to say about me if I try to give them a gospel tract? Others are afraid of sacrifice. They're scared to death of sacrifice. And it's evident today in the church, people are afraid of sacrifice. Because people can't even show up to honor the Lord on his day and be faithful to God's house. Away with this stuff. Well, I can be a good Christian without the church. Baloney. Baloney. You can't be a good Christian without the house of God. Y'all probably don't believe that, but I believe it. I don't know what's wrong with y'all today. Y'all ain't doing no ameners. Forfeited by fear. Scared to death. The devil says boo and they hide. And then it was a place where frailty was featured. Now the Bible says in verse 16, I'm about to close. I know some of you will be thankful for this. But in verse 16, he divided the 300 men into three companies, and he put a trumpet in every man's hand with an empty pitcher and lamp within those pitchers, fire within them pitchers. Verse 17, he said unto them, look on me and do likewise. Behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall you do. You just follow me. Why? He's the pastor. He's the pastor. Pastor Gideon. What do you want us to do, preacher? Good night. When's the last time I heard that? I hear a lot of this. We're going to do this. Not here. Frailty was featured because to each was given a trumpet, an empty pitcher, and a lamp. And on a given signal, they were to blow the trumpet. That was for warning people of war. They were to blow the trumpet. And they were to break the pitchers. That speaks of brokenness before God. Oh, how these pitchers need to be broken today. God cannot use these vessels unless they're broken. And then shout the sword of the Lord in Gideon, the word of God. That's the whole plan of attack right there. Broken. God uses. Oh, M. Ardahan got a good little old book. Dr. M. Ardahan. If you know anything about him, you ought to read this little book. I know it might be out of print, but order it. God uses broken things. We cast them aside. We throw them out. But God uses broken things. Boy, that'll preach. Just let me show you. He uses broken clouds to give rain. He uses broken bread to feed 5,000. The sacrifices of God, church, this morning are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. God will not despise that. God used Mary's alabaster box that was broken. She broke it open. Boy, that fragrance started filling that house. If you want to start smelling sweet before others, just get broken. For we are unto God a sweet savor, a fragrance unto them that are saved and unto them that are lost. Lost people will realize you've been with Jesus. You are a broken individual. There's a sweet fragrance coming out of your life. God used the broken body of Jesus on Calvary. Hallelujah. To save people. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. The seed of every church, somebody was broken. people over in Nigeria right now are getting their heads cut off by the thousands because of their faith. Muslims are cutting their heads off, attacking them. It's not over. People are still being martyred for Jesus. I don't know when it's coming here. Frailty is also featured by the dream the Midianite soldier had. Look at verse 14, what a dream. He dreamed of a biscuit coming into camp. Barley cake, whatever. Verse 14, and his fellow answered and said, "This is nothing save the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. For under this hand hath God delivered Midian and all the host." And I don't know where it's at. It's in there somewhere. I've got it in my Bible. But listen, he says in these verses, he saw a barley cake come into the camp, and it destroyed the camp. What did he see? He saw a biscuit. Overturned the tents, a biscuit. Frailty. You know what? What I would have said if a salt biscuit come into camp? Where's the gravy? Medium was being bombed by barley biscuits. But those barley biscuits were thrown by God. Can you see God up there? Barley biscuit. Folks, you see humor in this stuff. I do. I really do. I'd like to make a movie out of this. Biscuits from glory. Barley from heaven. Frailty, 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 frailty. God can use a barley cake. You ain't no fruitcake yet, are you? Amen. And so, let me close out. It was a place where it was fortified by faith. Frailty was seen. It faced a fight. Few were found. It was fortified by fear. Frailty was featured, but it was fortified by faith. They had faith in a living God, verse number 20. And the Bible says, they blew the trumpets, break the pitchers, and held the lamps in their hands, and the trumpets in their right hand to blow withal, and they cried the sword of the Lord. And of Gideon. There was their faith. You know what faith does? Faith sees the invisible, hears the unaudible, believes the incredible, and attempts the impossible. Is the church to be operated by faith? It sure is. Operated by faith, not by sight. Fortified by faith. And they were found in God's place. And not only were they in God's place, God stood with them in that place. So we need men today, fathers, who will get in their place. Because we're out of place. In closing, a father made a checklist of seven things that he would do differently if his children were small again. I read that. Number one, he said, I would love the mother of my children more. That is, I would be more free to let my children see that I love her. Number two, I would listen more. Most fathers find it hard to listen because they're often preoccupied and a child's talk seems so trivial. It is estimated that the average child asks 500,000 questions by the age of 15. 500,000. Number three, I would seek more opportunities to give my child a feeling of belonging, which is essential for a child's security and feeling of self-worth. Number four, I would express words of appreciation and praise more. Many children hear criticism, but never commendation. Number five, I would spend more time together. Several years ago, a survey indicated that the average dad spent and his son spent together was 7.5 minutes per day. Number six, I'd laugh more with my family. Boy, fun times are not forgotten. You know that? Number seven, I would spend more time in Bible reading and prayer with my family. The family altar would alter the family. Then let me add an eighth one. If you want to be the dad God wants you to be, you must, through a personal saving, have a personal saving faith in Jesus Christ and be born again. Only a saved father can be a right kind of father. Man, I read those and I said, wow, I wish I had a second chance. You know, I wish I could go and do some things over. Because you can get so drowned in church work and pastoring and all that and neglect your family. Neglect your children. God help us as fathers. God help our fathers. If you're here and you're a dad, you're here today, you've never been saved, call on him. He'll save you. Jesus will save you. Mom, if you're here and you've never trusted Christ, he'll save you. You don't have to die lost. You can go to heaven. You can have eternal life. Because Christ died for you. He's buried and he rose again the third day. That's the power of the gospel. Let's pray together. Heads bowed and every eye closed. We're going to sing a song of invitation. I'll be down here in the front. If you need to come and pray. Father, I pray now and during this invitation. Lord, I pray this morning in this service that we'll just obey you, that we'll find our place and be right in our place where you put us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand quietly to our feet, please.
305, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided, oh, I will decide to follow Jesus. Will you decide today?
No turning back.
Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, Lord, I still will follow. No turning back. Let's sing that. I have decided, just the chorus. I have decided. Will you decide today to follow Jesus? I have decided. What about it, Mom, Dad, son, daughter? You decide right now. Maybe too late. Tonight or the next Sunday. No turning back. Just stand if you would please for just a few moments, and we want to remind you of the announcements in the bulletin. Josh, we're glad to have you as a member. Be a business meeting tonight after the church. June 26th, the children's field trip. Please sign up for that and read about it in the bulletin. July the 18th, ladies will be having their mission meeting again. Birthdays, Jessica Yelvington and Brenna Carmichael. Where's she at? That there she is. Happy birthday, honey. Happy anniversary to Hugh and Betty Corson. 60 long years. Hugh, smile a while. Give your face a rest. Raise your hand to the one you love the best. We love you, Brother Hugh. Okay, all right. Okay. If he ever changes his mind, he'll let you know. Happy anniversary, y'all. 60 years. Praise God. So that's just some of the announcements in your bulletin. All right. Remember tonight at 6 o'clock, Wednesday nights at 7. Remember the services. Thank y'all for coming out today. Amen. Dads, we love you. We honor you today. We love you. Amen. Thank God for the men of our church. Amen. And the dads of this church. Let's just lead our children and families the right way. Amen. Okay, we'll be dismissed in prayer. And visitors, thank you for coming. We got something for the men. Praise God. Praise God. Give Hugh something. Give him two things. It's his anniversary, too. Brother Gene, would you dismiss us in prayer, brother?